I was checking the
Get off your phone.
I'm not a millennial. I was just checking the feed.
Sorry. I apologize for my French on here.
It's all good.
I'm sorry. This is tough. I'm sorry, Dave.
It's all good. Welcome to Musicians on the Record. I am David Ward. This is the show where we get the musician story, and we're doing take two because we finally found the right channel. We are on the show today with the voice drummer Nate Morton and guitarist and multi-instrumentalist, try to say that five times fast, extraordinaire Sean Halley. These guys have got a great new project called Fraud Prophets. Their new album is called Poptosis. We are very blessed and grateful to have them on the show, and we're having a lot of fun. They're in their studio in LA. We're in the MOTR Studios in Portland, Maine. Wherever you're listening and watching from in the world, tell us in the chat. We're going to hang with these guys, ask about the voice, ask about the album, ask how to become a pro musician. I'm still trying to figure it out, but we have Nate and Sean on the show. Welcome, guys.
Hey, how you doing, Dave?
I'm doing
great. Thank you, sir. Appreciate you having us on. Thank you.
Absolutely. My
pleasure. And by the way, your dog is awesome, by the way.
Thank you so much.
Your dog is cute.
Thank you so much. That's Bob. Well, Bob just, Bob the pug took off for a little bit. He'll be back, so... All right.
That's awesome.
So let's talk about the new album, Poptosis. Let's do a sort of a recap of how this all even came about.
Well, in short, I've known Sean for a long, long time. And it's almost like kind of ridiculous that it took us this long to do this. But essentially, I bullied Sean into doing it because he's an extremely talented cat, as anyone who listens to this record is gonna hear. And for the longest time, I felt like, why am I the only guy who knows that this dude is a genius? More people should know that. And essentially, I browbeat him into it, and we finally managed to get together one night and start creating some of the kernels that went on to become this this record.
He's very nice to me. I don't deserve any of that, but it's very nice of him to say. So yes. But we've been buddies like 15, 16 years.
A long time.
And obviously, we've been big fans of each other, and there's nobody that I'd sort of rather hear.
Be bullied into a record by?
Totally. Yeah. There's no one that I would rather be bullied into anything by than Nate. So we ended up sort of starting the half of the process in mid-2016.
I don't even know.
Yeah. Finished the other half of the process in, 2017. And then... Anyway, so we finished and we launched it
about
3 weeks ago. Exactly. Tap out.
Tap anyway, out.
Yeah, exactly. So we finished it and launched it about 2 weeks ago. And so far, the response has been incredible. People that should know way better are saying really nice things. So we're really gratified by it, which is great.
That's fantastic. And where can people get Poptosis?
So it is available on iTunes, on Amazon, and on CD Baby.
Amazon. Is this like Downton Abbey?
Sorry, my wife's English. I apologize.
Amazon?
Sorry, I
you know what's really funny? Yeah. Someone asked me where he can get it, and I said, oh, man, you can get it everywhere. Right. And they were like, really? Like Home Depot?
Yeah.
I was like, everybody's got jokes.
Oh, yeah.
Everyone's going to be joking. So it's one word. So on iTunes, you'll find it with one word, Fraud Prophets. Amazon, it's one word, Fraud Prophets. On stores.cdbaby.com, you can find it. If you just go to fraudprophets.com and click on the Buy Poptosis link, it'll take you to – it has links for everywhere you can find it.
Will you have a graphic for this that you can share?
Yeah, we've got
– I only ask because I tell people to search for the title, Poptosis, because that's sometimes easier to find. Because I've had people tell me, I can't find it. And I go, oh, try Fraud Prophets as one word. And they're like, oh, okay. But sometimes I just say search the title as well.
Yeah. But it's available, and you can listen to snippets on iTunes and on the CD Baby. I'm not sure if you can on Amazon, but you can hear snippets of it. The record goes all over the place. So it has straight ahead jazz elements. It has rock elements. It has R&B. It's got blues. It's got funk. It's got a country thing on there. It has some roots sort of.
It's basically involved. Based around our collective musical background.
Mm.
Yeah.
And say a little bit more from where you guys come from musically and how you put that into the album.
Well, I mean, for me, I'll just say philosophically, like the first records I ever owned, the first record album that I ever bought was Kiss Dynasty.
Nice.
And so then it went from Kiss Dynasty to Peter Frampton to George Clinton. And then I later started listening to more jazz as I got into high school. I started listening to more reggae. And sort of, I've known musicians who have progressed through phases. Now I'm in the rock phase. Now I'm in the jazz phase. That's all I listen to. Yep. Now I'm in the this phase. That's all I listen to. And so fortunately for me, for one reason or another, I was able to sort of move and add phases without leaving anything behind. So I'm still as connected to the rock things I began listening to early on. And so, you know, one way or another now, when I sit down to play, I'm able to sort of bring all those elements along with me, you know?
And I am the stringed equivalent of that. So I grew up the first, I basically was sneaking into my parents' room at 5 and 6 years old, completely on the sly, to listen to Elton John's Yellow Brick Road, you know, basically. So it was one of those things where
Bob was barking, and I didn't want that to interrupt you guys.
He was Bob Barker.
So Bob Barker was in your room.
I love it. Fantastic.
Buzzing.
Yeah. Sorry, I didn't. The hand signals. I was trying to figure out whether I should stop or keep going. Sorry,
all good. My bad. All good. Yeah. Go for it.
No, but I was just trying to say that my background is similar. For me, it was Elton John, and as a 5 or 6 year old, and then it was rock things, and I added.
Why did you have to sneak and listen?
Because I was 5 or 6 years old, and it was
forbidden fruit. Like, you're not allowed to hear. Thou shalt not. It was hear of the Elton John.
It was a turntable. It was a turntable.
Oh, so you're gonna break the needle.
The needle, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Like, Dad was like, "It's a Sony. You stay the hell away from that."
I remember.
Yeah. So
first day, my dad saw me holding an album, like holding it like that. He was like. Hold it like this,
My dad had the little, remember the little brush, the brush that you held, so you put the juice.
Oh yeah,
Totally. Yeah. Sure. So as a 5 or 6 year old, I was trying to use the juice and put the thing, but it was like, you know, you'd put it down, Anyway, so I was not allowed, but I loved the pictures and I started out that way. But my experience is the same. So I added reggae and country and funk and all that kind of stuff, but I never really lost any of the other stuff that I liked. I still. You know, there are sections on this record that go from drop B, ridiculous rock, straight into a swung section. It's an interesting thing. The good thing, though, I think about it, and I think you would agree, is that what's nice about the way that we came up, both of us, is that because we never dropped any of those other things that we like, we still have our own musical personality in each one of those things. And so when the record goes between all these different feels and stuff, it still sounds like us, which is cool.
That's fantastic. Sure. Yeah. Want to give a shout out to Laura Frost. She is watching and says hello from Ohio.
Awesome. Ah. Where in Ohio? My whole family's from Ohio. Oh, that's
very
awesome.
Very cool. Where in Ohio, Laura? You can let us know. So
awesome.
The album sounds like a real meld of stuff that you guys love, stuff that you were inspired by.
Right.
Let's talk about some of the songs. And some of your, probably all your favorites, but which ones are you kind of real jazzed by right now?
I think the first song is a good one to sort of check out, and it's the reason why it's the first song on the record, because it's
A good introduction.
Yeah, it's a good.
It's a good introduction to what's coming.
Yeah, it's like a pre-foreshadowing to everything that's on the record, because it's got some rock in it, it has some funk in it, it has some jazz stuff in it, it has a roots element, it has a.
I think I just said that. That's the name of the song.
But it's okay.
Get it? Get it?
Yes.
That's the name of the song. The name of the song is I Think I Just Said That.
Yeah, it's true. It's true. That's exactly.
I had a meeting. I had like a writer's meeting on the way here. So
there
I got it.
There you go.
I got it ready to go. Got it ready to go.
Wow. You got them loaded up. It's like you had another cartridge in the spinner.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Totally.
The synapses are clicking now. That's really good.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Let's give.
So, yeah, I think.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Go ahead. Sorry. No, please.
I was just going to say, let's give some of the other musicians who are also on the album some love and tell me about some of the other folks who joined you guys.
Well, so when Nate was on the Bonnie Hunt show back in the day, which is a very much a jazz-centric kind of a gig. It was kind of a big band gig. It was Reggie Hamilton and you and Cheche Alero and all these guys. Bob Reynolds was the tenor sax player on that show, and he's brilliant. Wow. And he's now well-known for being a solo artist as well, being in Snarky Puppy. So he's the guy that you hear all the amazing tenor solos from Snarky Puppy. So he's on a track.
Wow. Janae Fleener.
Janae Fleener.
Osnoy.
Yep. Osnoy and also our friend Matt Rohde on Hammond B3. So Osnoy's on a track. Janae Fleener plays an amazing fiddle on this tune called Eat a Frog, which sounds like a new Mark O'Connor Nashville Cats kind of a tune. And
I was just thinking that.
That's because you don't know that record.
I was thinking that. No, I was thinking that exact thing. I was like, yeah, that sounds like who?
I think I just
Jimmy
stopped.
Connors.
I think I just
Jimmy Connors.
It was
Jimmy
Connors. It was Sally Field
something
and Jimmy
about
Connors.
Jimmy Connors.
It was Jimmy Connors and Christina. It was Grace Jones. who was on the record? Anyway, yeah. So all those guys are friends of ours, and we basically made them play on our record, which was nice.
We tricked them
for scale or something like that, right? So it's
we totally tricked them we told people that we would reveal elements about their lives that they wouldn't want to be revealed. It was blackmail, basically.
It's a blackmail album. That's fantastic.
Yeah,
I love it.
Totally, it's different than the Black album from right. Metallica. It's the Blackmail album, and it's Poptosis.
I love it. And I know we covered this a minute ago, but can you say a little bit about the origin of the name of the album, Poptosis? Where did that come from?
So the part of the thing about being a musician like Nate and I are, like Nate's on The Voice and plays every style of music on the planet and kills it. My thing is definitely, as a session guy, has always been this accuracy for multiple genres and things. The problem is that, you know, if you're a normal musician who has imposter syndrome, where you figure that someone's going to figure you out,
right.
You know, it's sort of like a fake jazz record. So we're sort of, no, it's not really fake jazz.
I would just say that the title references the fact that even in a jazz mode, there are still pop elements to it.
Yes.
I would simply say that. Sure. You know what I mean? Right. It's still at times very singable, or it's still melody centric.
Yes.
You know, it's not a math record.
Totally
meant to be, you know, deliberately highbrow. It's very much a musical effort first.
Yeah,
and it's organic. It's definitely organic. It has elements where there are some challenging things here and there, but they never get in the way of the fact that it's organic and singable and relatable. So they're definitely, you're right. It's not a
really, yeah, really quick. You know, yeah. It's like sometimes people. I came from a classical piano background, and people would refer to it. If I ever said I'm playing a song, they would go, "It's not a song. It's a piece." Mm. And so, I guess I say that to say this. This record is not pieces. This record is songs.
Yeah.
And are there vocals as well, or is it mostly instrumental?
It's all instrumental.
All instrumental.
So we do, you know, both of us do vocally things in other parts of our lives, but this is definitely an instrumental record.
Yeah. That's great. And any plans to take this live? I mean, besides our live show here, but any plans to do some live performances, go on the road?
So we want to do that. Yeah. So the first order of business is to find some players that work with our bizarre mentality. Like the bass player has to sort of play straight ahead jazz, but like Lemmy and Motorhead.
I was going to say we're going to go on tour. Yeah. Our first tour date is going to be beside the trampoline in my backyard. That's our first. As our first date, then we're going to be
22
maybe
children.
Maybe at Lulu's bowling alley.
Sure.
Maybe we'll manage a gig there at some point.
Maybe we're really aiming high here.
Yeah. No, we have every intention of doing this live in front of folks. I mean, you know, that's the true essence of capturing kind of what we do is to be able to do it in front of folks, you know. So.
Yeah, we've gotten a bunch of feedback from people that have seen the video content we put out and that have heard the record and things, and we hear lots about the fact that they really like the record. We hear lots about the fact that it's enjoyable and listenable multiple times, which has been very gratifying. And we have contemporaries of ours that have called and texted to let us know how much they're enjoying it, which is really nice. But as well, that people like the fact that we're dorks, and they really do, bro. Sorry, you can.
That's Mr. Dork. Yeah.
Okay, listen here. I'm just saying that being live and being in front of people would be a really great thing, I think, because you have to see him play drums. It's just it's the greatest thing. He's the most joyful cat in the world behind a kit.
Yeah. Well, speaking of that, we actually have a little bit of that. We were able to grab a clip. Do you want to do that right now, you guys?
Is it of the drum cam?
Let's go to the clip.
Drum cam?
It is of the drum cam. Nate Morton from The Voice.
Do I need to set this up? Do I set this up? I don't even know what you're going to play.
If you would like to.
I'm just totally, I'm completely just being silly, David. I'm sorry.
Well, that's what it's all about, right? That's what it's all about.
Was my character feeling during this? Was my character off camera? That's what my character was off camera.
So I'm a drummer.
Yes.
And in this clip, I portray a drummer.
What's
the plot is, I'm playing the drums.
What's your motivation, Nate? What's your motivation behind all of this?
My motivation is I'm playing the drums.
So this is this is you on The Voice, Nate.
Yeah.
Just killing it. Beautiful kit. I don't know if you can see or hear this.
No.
I can't see or hear it, buddy.
Okay, well, you're doing fantastic. I'm not hearing I'm not hearing anybody with a voice. You're just killing it on the drums.
Oh, this tune, right. So this is from my drum cams, which is something that I started doing a while ago.
Yeah.
Where I just put up, basically I try to shoot as much as I can and I try to post so that for drummers out there kind of going like, oh, you know, what's that cat doing? Like, I think back to me as a kid when I would have been watching a talk show, for example, and I'm hearing a drummer play, but I'm like, I wish I could see him. I wish I knew what he was doing.
Yes.
So that's all that this is. You know what I mean? This is just my way of giving a little bit of access to people who might be interested.
It's really great. It's fantastic. Can we talk a little bit about, in addition to the album, can we talk about The Voice and how'd you get the gig? What's it like being on The Voice? All of it.
Hit me with a question. What's your give me your specific
So let's start with how'd you get the gig?
Okay. This is an extremely long story, but I'm going to make it really short because I know that we don't have a ton of time. Okay. It's a question that I get asked a lot. How did I get the gig? And what I'll simply say is this: that gig came as the result of a relationship that began between myself and my big brother, Paul Merkovich, who is the musical director on that show, and my other big brother, Sasha Krivtsov, who is a bass player on that show. And the three of us first worked together on a show called Rockstar, which was on CBS back in 2005, 2006. And so from that genesis, we moved as a unit from one gig to the next. So we did two seasons of that show. We did another show together on I don't know if that actually made air, but it was another situation that we did together. We played with Cher together. We played with Paul Stanley together. And one thing led to the other. And when the Cher gig came to a close for us in Vegas, Paul, through the connections that he had with Mark Burnett from having worked on Rockstar, basically that connection came and led us to being the band on the show The Voice. So when people say, how'd you get that gig? As if it were maybe like an audition on a Wednesday and I had the gig on the following Monday. It's not. It was literally an audition that began in 2005, you know, and just grew into a relationship that one thing led to the other. And then that's where it is now.
I think what's important about that is that it's important, I think, for young people or for people that are trying to figure out how to break into something like this. Yes. It's important that people understand that relationships are everything in this business.
And relationships are everything.
Everything.
Absolutely.
It's you know, and you can try to crunch it down to like a corporate thing, like it's networking or whatever. But it's not. It's really about having authentic relationships with people so that they feel confident. Because one thing that's really important to know about a show like this or about a session with an orchestra in the same room as you or whatever, is that it is an unbelievable amount of money that is flowing past the time clock every hour.
Right.
Like, so I went and saw the finale rehearsals for The Voice a few weeks ago, and there are no less than 70 grips on stage moving sets between station breaks.
Amazing.
So, you know, there are 100 people, 110 people in the room getting paid by the hour.
Yeah.
So it's intensely important that whoever is there and hiring you feels confident that you're going to be able to pull off the gig and do it right and be the right guy and look and smell right and be, you know, it's a submarine. And it's really important that, you know, those relationships are the things that bring you to the next thing, because people are confident in what you do. They like what you do, and they're confident that you are going to make them look good. I mean, Paul knows that every time you nail a kick-ass fill, which you do every song, that it makes him look good. It makes him look like, oh yeah, dude, you hired the right guy every time.
Yeah. Well, at the end of the day,
that was my analysis, by the way. Sorry, I'm just
you're okay.
I'm not on the show, so I figured that I have to be able to talk about something. Right. I mean,
we'll get to you, Sean, too.
I'm totally kidding. There's nothing interesting about me. Go, can you?
No. I just wanted to reemphasize. People sometimes ask when did you get your big break?
Yeah,
and I basically say I will let you know when it happens,
right?
Because it hasn't ever felt like that to me. It's always just felt like one thing has led to the next.
Yeah.
So, you know, and in fact, you know, I'm sorry, I don't mean to ramble, but I just want to elaborate just a little bit on
that.
Please,
talk all you want.
In terms of a big break, you know, and I think you may relate to this as well, Shawnee, but it's like, so when I got out of school, my first gig that I got was with a cover band, and it was a full-time gig playing covers in Boston. At that level, that was my big break. Right. I went from being a college student to being a full-time musician. Yeah. The next gig that I got after that was playing with a young woman, a Cantonese pop artist named Fei Wong, and she toured. And I went to Hong Kong and played the Hong Kong Coliseum. And at that point, that was my big break, because that was the biggest thing I had done. Right. The next gig was I played with Dale Bozzio. No, I played with All for One. That was my first sort of American tour. That was my big break at the time. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So it's just felt like a progression. I moved to Los Angeles. I was fortunate to get whatever gig that was. And then it was like, wow, I'm an LA musician and I got a gig in Los Angeles. Right. That was my big break at the time. So that's why no single instance in history feels really like, quote unquote, my big break.
Sure.
And so again, just circling all the way back around in my long-winded sort of dissertation,
yeah.
Circling all the way back around, the how did you get the gig on The Voice was just a part of that progression.
Right.
And it started in 2005 when I met Paul Berkovich and played with he and Sasha for the first time as a unit.
Right. But it sounds like for both of you guys, your musicality, your musical facility and flexibility with different genres serves you really well, not only for this album, but getting gigs like The Voice, and because this is all kinds of different stuff, pop, rock, all of it, right?
The voice has every kind of style on it you could imagine. Like if you look at Nate's drum cams, in a way, your drum cams are a really good microcosm of that show, because sometimes you're playing brushes and you've got horns, and then sometimes you're banging out in a wife beater. Mm-hmm. I saw that the other day, by the way. You didn't escape. And then sometimes it's a country thing, or sometimes it's a blues thing. It's like in order to make that gig work and make it tick for a live audience,
yes.
You have to have something extra in you than just being able to play like the record. Like I think you would agree that you guys play a lot of stuff with a rock edge.
Sure.
Yeah, but that actually helps the live. It's a live performance show. It's not, you're not playing a session every night where you're trying to just sort of, the goal is different. You've got to be a performer as well as nailing.
Yeah, you have to lift the music off.
Yeah,
the page.
Totally. Yeah, you got to. Yeah. I'm just saying that it's like, you know, it's not just about being able to hack it. It's about, you know, like I remember seeing John Scofield years ago talk about improvisation, and he was like, young people talk about making the changes.
Yeah.
You've heard that phrase, which is like, oh yeah, cool. I played the solo over Giant Steps and I made the changes. And an experienced guy will tell you, it's not about making the changes. It's about playing ideas in time. It's about being able to elevate what's going on to whatever the next level is. And you totally do that every time you play drums.
Okay, this is enough about me. I feel uncomfortable.
Too many compliments.
No, that's good. No, I want to keep talking about you.
No.
Well, we'll come back. We'll come back to Nate. We got time. Sean, tell us a little bit about your story, your music. So you're a producer as well as a guitarist.
So Sean was born in...
Yeah, exactly. It's true. That's where we'll have to go back and do it. That's true. I was born in Memphis, Georgia. No. I think the thing about my career that's weird is that it has been equal parts music and equal parts sort of like job. Mm. So I moved to L.A. in 99. And I moved down to work with a producer friend of mine who had done a couple big records. And we had worked together producing half of a record each for this artist named Emily Richards, who's a friend of mine. And she now runs ccmixter.org and a bunch of stuff. But at that point, she had the most popular downloaded record at the time. Mm. Like it was 3 million copies that she sold of that record. And I did half of it and he did half of it.
Wow.
And so we got along and figured, hey, I'll come down and work. And then I immediately learned what LA was like, because I've been here 3 weeks and he asked me for a loan. So that was like, oh shit, I made the wrong decision. Oh dear. But you know, so I basically was here and I worked with a couple big artists for a second, and then sort of got in financial trouble. And took a day gig. And so I have been
a musician in financial trouble? That's so weird.
It's unheard of, right?
So, yeah.
That so, never happens.
Yeah. So I took a job in the music instrument manufacturing space. So I was at Tascam for a long time, and I was at Avid and Digizine for 9 years as a Pro Tools HD and Icon console ninja for North America. And I was a lot of people know from Line 6. where I did a lot of product videos. So I've done a lot of video content. Okay. So I've been known, you know, I'm known in some circles as a presenter for audio things and that kind of stuff. But I've continued to play guitar and play bass and keyboards and compose things. I used to write film trailer music for New Line Cinema, so like 50-piece orchestral stuff. So my life has been all about, I'm like a cat chasing an LED, the laser pointer. So if you do this on the ground with the cat's like, oh Jesus, a laser, and he chases it. I'm sort of like that about a subject. So it's like, oh food, ah cool, oh cars, whatever video. So I'm that guy. I'm the cat chasing the proverbial red laser. Yeah. Only I've tried to do it and continued to be able to afford a mortgage, which is tricky. But
got to pay the bills, right? So you got to do what you do. And who else have you produced, Sean, and helped with their music career too?
Well, I think my most successful, like all those names would be very small names, you wouldn't know them. But I think my most successful bit has been in the corporate, in the commercial world. Okay. So as a session guy, I was the guy that if someone made a funny joke on the new Hollywood Squares and there was a wah-wah guitar lick, that was me. If you were playing a Sony PlayStation game and it was Twisted Metal, you know, there's a bunch of guitar players on there, but it's in all likelihood you would hear something from me. If you're watching the Canadian Broadcasting Network and you watch the nightly news and you heard someone go,
that's you?
That was me. Yeah. So I did a lot of – so the problem with that kind of stuff is that commercial music is faceless and it's nameless. You don't get – you know, you don't say who – played all this stuff. So, but I was very busy in that world for a long time. Fox Sports News and ABC and stuff. So that was where a lot of my formal years came from. And I didn't move to LA until after I'd done a lot of that stuff, which was good. So I got a chance to be a big fish in a very small pond, which meant that I got way more experience in those worlds than I would have normally, because a lot of work was coming out of LA to Salt Lake, where I was at the time, because it was cheaper. So because it was less expensive, I was able to do a lot of stuff that if I just moved right to LA, I would have still been getting tea for Roy Thomas Baker for 5 years, you know, long after I was able to actually, like, you know, score actual films and stuff. So that's me. So basically, Nate and I met on this great record for a friend of ours named Michael Thompson, who's a session guitar player. Mm. Michael, in his heyday, was one of the guys. So in the late 90s, he was probably on 8 out of the 10 top 10 number, like, singles at the time. So, like, you know, in 97, I think it was N Street, Backstreet Boys, Tony Braxton, David Foster, Babyface, all this stuff. So he was nice enough to bring us on, and Nate played drums on half the record. I played bass on half the record. And that was where we met, and we've sort of been inseparable ever since.
It's fantastic. You know, I think what you some of what you guys are really saying too is that with the music business today, you kind of need to diversify. It's not always just putting out an album these days. There is TV, there are movies, there are commercials, there are video games. And for someone looking to make music their living, kind of have to do a bunch of that stuff because things have changed quite a bit, right? Sure.
Totally. Yeah, the budgets are completely different. The delivery method is different. The gestation period for how long something is allowed to take is a third as long nowadays. So, you know, the challenge in this is that everyone in the music business knows that you can do stuff in your house in a week. Right. The problem is that means you have to do stuff in your house in a week because they're not willing to pay for you to go to Westlake for 2 days to do it.
Yes.
So, so the challenge is getting your skills together and to the point where you can make good sounding stuff yourself, but that still means that you have to figure out how to be an artist too, and figure out how to actually contribute to a recording or a production project and give it what it needs to happen. So I remember we're talking 10 years ago, you were working with a website company that was actually doing online sessions. So like you could book, and that was nascent. It was in its.
I always tell people to sort of get their, at least drummers, that if they're able to get their recording chops together, that's always a good sort of thing to have in your back pocket. Even if it's only, you know, your drum set in a room with 4 microphones and you have a reasonable grasp of Pro Tools, it's important to do that because it might not necessarily, lead to you buying your home in Malibu, but. You know, there can be a stream of income that comes from that, or a certain amount of flexibility that comes from that. So, yeah.
Sure. And I love what you guys said, too. Whether we call it networking, whether we call it relationships, it really is all about that and each step of the way, right? So,
absolutely.
Yeah, and the importance.
Yeah, there are people. Yeah, there are people that can. I think we all know people that are anomalies. We've all met and worked with people in the industry that is an anomaly to that thing, where they're not really nice people, or they're not really open and engaging as people.
Side guys.
Yeah, but not side guys.
I don't know side guys who can be jerks and remain employed.
Yeah, no, it's true.
In fact, I've known several side guys who are formerly employed because they were.
I'd like to play in this band, but I only want to be the one guitar player.
You got to play well with the other kids, right? So
you totally do. Yeah. You absolutely have to do. And if the artist plays guitar, you should consider the fact that it'd be okay if they play guitar while you do as well. Anyway.
Who, Nate, going back to the voice for a minute, we'll sort of go back and forth. You know, you see the judges, obviously, and you see who's singing.
Coaches.
The coaches, I apologize. Yep, okay.
And that's okay. No, you know what? You know what? And I don't mean to be a jerk,
no,
but I do make it a point to make that distinction because they don't judge.
Got it.
The you know what I mean? They literally, there are other shows where they do judge and they, you know, at times ridicule.
Yes.
And our cast of coaches are there to do literally what a coach does, which is help you improve as an artist. But I'm sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off. I didn't mean to be snarky.
No, not at all.
It's important to me always to make that distinction about our show, because that's one of the things that I think keeps it positive and fresh and energetic.
Right. And that's a great distinction. Thank you for letting me know. And the other shows, those who shall not be named, we won't even go there. But, but you know, you see the coaches and you see the singers, but I don't ever really see the musicians who are in the background like you. And tell us, who else is in the band?
Sure. The band on that show is my big brother, Paul Merkovich, is our musical director. Sasha Krivtsov.
He plays keys.
Yeah.
But you should tell him that he plays keys.
I'm sorry. Okay. Can I just answer the man's question?
I'm sorry. I'm going to look at my
people. Know Paul. People know Paul plays keys.
Look,
Paul is famous. People know that.
My cuticles need attention. Sorry. Continue.
So Paul Merkovich is our musical director and plays keys. Sasha Krivtsov is our bass player, and we have another keyboard player named Eric Daniels, who I call the musical dentist because he basically fills in all the holes. Who am I leaving out? Oh, and we have at certain points we have one guitarist, at certain points we have two guitarists, but those guitar spots are filled by Justin Derrico, who is currently on tour with Pink, or Dave Barry, longtime Cher and Janet Jackson guitarist.
Yeah.
Or Dory LaBelle, who is a guitar player in town who, you know, has a list of credits to his own name. So that's the band.
That's
the band. And as the show progresses in the live rounds, you do see us downstage periodically. Okay. But yeah, it's much more about the contestants.
Sure.
And, you know, I think that our role is in service to the music on that. So as long as I can be there doing that, I'm pretty happy.
Right. Yeah. Well, I'm going to put a plug in because, you know, I just had the pleasure of interviewing Anton Figg and his son, Aaron Figg, recently. And he, you know, Letterman always used to have him on the show in bits. So I think I think it would be great if the coaches have you on in bits and stuff like that. I'm just putting my plug in for that for you guys.
Right? They don't want our heads to get too big.
They should have you on, though. They should have you on bits.
Although brevity
might be a
problem. I'm good behind the
You're
drums.
Good behind
that's,
it.
That's
okay.
It. Yeah.
All right. Very good. Let us know your questions for Nate and Sean about Poptosis, their project fraudprofits.com, The Voice. If you want to know about Adam Levine, anything you want to ask, ask these guys, and they will tell you. Can you give us a glimpse for somebody who watches the show, Nate? What's a day in the life for you? Getting ready for that show, getting there, performing.
Sure. And I, you know, I don't want to take up too much of your time because all of these are very long answers and I'll do my best to sort of keep them, kind of short.
Go for it.
Everything changes depending on the time of the season that it is. So there are times in the season where the band is just the band and we're just rehearsing and learning songs. Mm-hmm. There are times, and those are kind of more relaxed times. There are times when we come in and learn 10 songs in the morning because we're going to be rehearsing them with, you know, 10 contestants in the afternoon, and that's going to be shot on camera, let's say. So a day might look like that. We have days when we actually go to Henson Recording Studios in Hollywood, and we record all the iTunes releases that are out on iTunes or to stream or however that's working these days. But more to the point, I'll give you a really quick overview of what our week looks like during the live shows. That's something that people ask me about.
Okay.
So the live shows are live. It's like when you see us on there, that's when we're on there. So our week begins something like this. Day one is Wednesday. Wednesday morning, we get the songs. We rehearse them that morning. Noon, we shoot reality with the contestants and coaches. Day two is Thursday, second rehearsal with the contestants. Day three, we go to iTunes and record for iTunes. Mm. Right, all the releases. Okay. So that's Friday. Day four is Saturday. We rehearse all day on stage for Monday's show. Day five is Sunday. We rehearse all day on stage for Tuesday's show. Monday, run through in the morning, show at night. Tuesday, run through in the morning, show at night. Okay. 7 days a week.
Wow.
So a lot of the time people ask me, they'll say, hey man, so besides The Voice, you know, what are you up to? Because the perception is that the show's on two nights a week, so you're only working 2 days a week. Right. What are you doing the other 5 days a week?
Right. Yeah.
But it takes those other 5 days a week to create those two nights a week.
Of course, absolutely. So how did you even find time, first of all, to do this interview, but also to do Fraud Profits and Poptosis?
Well, I'll just jump in really quickly and say, in terms of the show, we do have spaces. We do have a week off here, two weeks off there. Got so it's not 52 weeks out of the year. So that's where it fit in for me,
yes.
Shawnee.
But it is a lot, though. It is like you do get it is a week here or a week there. It's not like you're off for 4 months. It's not like a tour.
No.
You know, the difference between his gig is definitely that it's not like you're out with Tom Petty for like 3 weeks and then you're it is balls to the wall 7 days a week and then you rest.
But then we have little hiatuses here and there.
Yeah. So for me, most of the production of this record, I had a normal, you know, sort of like day job, but it was an 18-hour kind of thing. So we basically put it together in the little dark spaces.
Yes.
So, you know, I basically stole an hour here, an hour there, a morning here. Yeah. If you look at our Instagram or Facebook account, there's a video that I posted where I was actually working. You can see that I'm in a robe and it's 7:15 in the morning and I'm, you know, literally tracking a guitar solo. So it was definitely an effort to make sure that it didn't stall, if that makes sense.
Because
it could sometimes, it could be a month before I'd get a chance to be able to do anything else. If I was on the road or if I, you know, went to a trade show somewhere, I was gone or whatever. So it was definitely had to stay focused to make sure that I would finish it. So, but yeah, that's basically it. It was little stolen moments here and there. And then basically last August or September is when we sort of finished up everything. We started mastering in December and released it 2 weeks ago.
So. Amazing. And you look like you have a beautiful studio there, Sean, the board. Can we just get a glimpse of that?
That's a Digizine Icon. It's a 24 fader digital console. And then there's, you can see, let's see, wait, over there.
Oh, that's me again.
That's you again, but there's like,
hey,
like a pile of guitar amps and speaker cabinets and pedals and guitars. And
very cool.
So, you know, from a career of doing tons and tons of little sessions for things, there's 32 guitars hidden in the house.
Right.
So oftentimes you'll be looking for a towel and you go, God damn it, another Strat. But it's sort of how it is. Well,
I just had this image of you opening a closet door and just all these guitars just fall out.
Oh, it's not far off. It's not far off. And my wife is definitely very understanding. She's long suffering and understanding. So if she goes into the towel closet to try to find a hand towel for something and comes away with a towel,
a guitar pedal falls out.
So she had a guitar pedal fall on her from the second bedroom. There's a shelf in the second bedroom and it just had sheets on it. So she pulled the sheet off and it just like four pedals came out.
Oh my
like electronic roaches.
No.
Anyway, so she's very understanding. I love her to death. She's very, very, very understanding of me. She's accommodating. So.
And I do, by the way, just with your studio, I do love Lamp, by the way, right behind you. That's fantastic.
Nice. Yes. Yes. It's, that is the Lamp.
That's awesome.
From Whatchamajigger.
Oh,
it's
a Christmas
story. Christmas story.
Yeah, fantastic.
That is Story Legland. It is. It's Fragile. That was given to me by Johnny Resnick of the Goo Goo Dolls. So Johnny Resnick gave me that.
Thank you,
when I was at his studio once. He was like, dude, you want that? I'm like, I will totally take that right now. And his guitar player is a guy named Brad Fernquist, who's lovely. He's a really great player. But apparently Brad had designs on the lamp.
And was none too happy that I scooped the lamp.
Yeah, I had no idea.
I imagine there are others that you could get online that he could get, right? I mean, it's
totally good. Yes, exactly. And they're not all that cheap because it's a full size leg lamp.
Oh wow!
And I have there are six lava lamps that are off camera and turned off because it gets a little warm in here when you start turning all the gear on.
Yeah,
so as cool as they look on camera, they.
Are the opposite of cool.
They are the opposite of cool. Exactly. Right. Yeah. You turn enough tubes on and you start sweating. Yeah, it's no not doubt. Good. Not
so,
good at all.
So we do have a question. Laura Frost, again, who asked or said she lived near Cleveland or she lives near Cleveland. She's asking a question about The Voice. Nate, how is Adam Levine? What's he like?
Interesting. Adam is, you know, he's cool. He's Adam. And, you know, I mean, he, like all of them, I think that what I take away from Adam's, you know, my experience with Adam on the show is that each of the coaches sort of brings to it what they do. So in terms of Adam, so for example, we had Pharrell on, and Pharrell is most notably a producer. And so he comes at things from a producer's angle. We've got, you know, obviously Blake, who is a country artist. And so he comes at it from an angle of getting his contestants to connect with the meaning of a song. You know, because as a country artist, a lot of the time you're performing a song you didn't write.
Right.
Adam comes at it as a songwriter. So for him, it's all about finding the right song for a particular contestant. You know what I mean? So, yeah, I mean, that's his contribution. And he was cool to work with while he was there. He's
gone now.
There now. He's stepped away. And now we have this season's cast of coaches is going to bring back Gwen Stefani.
Oh, great.
Which is really cool. Yeah. So it's going to be, Blake, Kelly, Gwen, and who am I leaving out? Oh, John Legend.
Oh, wow.
So, yeah.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Excellent.
It's really cool. They're all amazing.
Yeah. Wasn't Adam one of the guys that always, like, go sit behind your drums and play your drums and stuff?
Adam, yeah, he used to do that a lot.
Get off my drums, bro.
Yeah, well, that kind of went away when I started telling him that he needed to trade me time in his, like, exotic sports cars.
Yeah, there you go.
Like, if you're going to play my drums, you got to let me drive, you know, the Ferrari or whatever. And so then suddenly he stopped playing my drums.
That's fantastic. Mm. So is he just back? He went back to his band, Maroon 5. They're going to do more work.
Do you know the truth?
Yeah.
I honestly don't know.
Okay.
The truth is I honestly don't know. Yeah.
Got
yeah.
Yep. Okay. All right. Yeah. Well, moving on. So I also want to I want to circle back a little bit. You mentioned your first record was Dynasty, Nate. And you also
the first record I ever bought.
You also
1978.
Yeah, right. Exactly. 78. And you also got to work with Paul Stanley. Tell us about that,
yes.
Please. He's a hero.
He's funny.
There have been times in my life when I've worked with an artist that I've never known.
Yeah.
And I met them that day, or I knew of them when I learned the material.
Yeah.
There have been times when I've worked with artists that I was a fan of. Mm. Then there's Paul Stanley.
Yeah.
When I'm working with an artist who, when I was 6 years old, I would pretend to be.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah.
So that's like, I mean, and again, we could do a whole follow-up chat on the Paul Stanley experience, because the first time that I ever met him was basically the show, the Rockstar show was on. Rockstar was on, and Paul Stanley saw that show and thought, I want those guys to back me up when I go do my solo tour. And so through connections of connections, he and his manager, Doc McGee, got in touch with Paul Merkovich, and we set up this dinner to hang out. So the band is all there. And it's just very funny because when Paul enters a place, like, you just, even if he's not doing anything special, you just feel an entrance being made.
Yeah, yeah.
And so when he walked in, it felt like in the old West, when, like, the fastest gun in the West walks into the saloon and they're like boom, they kick open the door, and boom, you know, and like the silhouetted, because the sun is out, like the silhouetted figure sort of emerges into the building, you know what I mean?
Is there like an acoustic guitar going?
Yes, exactly. Some spaghetti guitar going on, right?
Yeah, love it.
It's completely that. So, you know, I mean, I don't even know. It's hard to even put my mind or get my mind around knowing that, like, I got to work with this iconic rock legend.
Right.
And then to circle and put a point on that, not long ago on the show, we played All Right Now.
Mm.
Okay, so we played All Right Now,
sure.
And it airs. And I'm driving home, And I get a text from Paul Stanley that says something along the lines of, you know, you were killing it tonight on All Right Now. So just even that, that speaks volumes to how down to earth this dude is, that he goes, oh, Nate, oh, he sounds really good. I'm going to text him, and just text me. And I get a text. So I texted back, compliment from iconic rock legend. Check.
Exactly.
That's fantastic. So, I can't say enough great things about him.
Wasn't there a funny story about being a millionaire from that dinner?
Being a millionaire?
Something about...
I don't know.
I don't know. Remember that. I seem to remember that. When you came back from that, I remember I talked to you closely after that dinner, and it was sort of like he had some funny line about, you know, if he was going to be a millionaire, he should have started out with $5 million or something after divorce or something. It's funny, but anyway, but I remember you really enjoyed that. Like the tour was awesome, everything about him was just great. I remember talking.
Paul's amazing.
Yeah, he's really great, which is cool.
Paul's amazing.
Super cool.
Certainly a musical hero of mine as well. And who would be some dream musicians for both of you guys that you would love to play with, past or present, that you would just be like stoked to play with?
I'll let you take this one.
Okay. Well, the problem is it depends on I sort of have this aspirational, like if I were to answer this truly, like it would be an aspirational thing.
Okay.
And they wouldn't handle me being in the room. Like if it was Keith Jarrett today, but I'd have to make sure I give him a puke bag so that he got, you know, that he wasn't completely disgusted by my lack of vocabulary. You know what I mean? But I think, I don't know, for me, my, I grew up listening to bass players and guitar players and pianists. I love Keith Jarrett. I love Miles. I love Coltrane. I love Tom Petty. I love the guys from Level 42.
What's your drop everything gig? Like if the phone rings and it's like, oh my gosh, it's blah, drop everything, going on the road.
Oh, at the moment?
I got three.
What are yours?
Well, unfortunately, one of them is no longer with us.
Right.
That was Bowie.
Yeah, totally.
Bowie was a drop everything gig.
Yeah.
Peter Gabriel was a drop everything gig.
Yeah.
Are you ready for this one? You want to laugh?
No, wait.
You want to laugh?
Should I guess?
I mean, you can. You're never going to get it.
Is it Debbie Gibson?
Close. Yes, you are.
Tiffany?
No, because you're still in the same world. No, okay. little bigger.
Okay.
Reunited recently, on tour right now, in the UK.
Oh, I think I know.
Tell you what, sure. I would do that gig in a heartbeat. That would be so fun to do.
My nieces and
all the guys in the band give me totally. So much crap over that, and I'm like, dude, this is the best is. Totally. and you know what's funny too? Like, I mean, even that sort of unintentionally. But I'm just acknowledging this to myself as I think about it, sort of speaks to how eclectic, mm-hmm. you know, a background that is.
Yeah.
Peter
yeah.
Gabriel, Bowie, Spice Girls.
Yeah, totally. and I think like me, it would be like all of those.
Uh-huh.
And
Spice Girls as well?
Yeah, I think so. It'd be fun. It'd be fun.
It would be so fun.
Because it would be.
It would be so fun.
But like that, and then I'd have Lucinda Williams and I have like, there'd maybe
she's
like,
a drop everything?
No, well, it's just like. Well, no.
I said drop everything, Sean.
I don't know.
I didn't say put down a few things.
I can't
put some stuff over here.
I can't.
I said drop everything.
I can't emotionally understand this question because I don't have a gig.
So then every gig is a drop everything gig. Or is it that everything is a drop everything gig, or is it that you don't have anything to drop right now?
Exactly. It's
stop. No. Ow! I'm laughing so hard I gave myself a leg cramp.
I don't know.
Gosh.
I can't emotionally get in touch with that question.
Fraud profits.
Yeah. Fraud profits. That's a drop everything.
That's a drop everything gig.
Yeah, totally.
Absolutely. We get a call to go to Japan.
Oh.
We'll do it.
Done.
Let's go.
Yeah, I think this music will actually
take us to Japan.
Take us to Japan and Europe eventually, I think, because it's that kind of thing. It's got chops and it has soul and it has funkiness and it has weirdness and it's got all that stuff together. So I think it will eventually have a home there.
I hope people listen to it. I hope that we're not so off-putting that people are like, "Who are those bozos? I'm never listening to that." I hope they're like, "Those guys are really goofy. Anything they record is probably really goofy. Let me check it out."
You know what's really weird? I hope people do listen to this, and the reason I say that is because. We obviously live in a world where we're around musicians a lot. And so it's very easy for us to get myopic about how something's going to be received because a lot of our friends are really good musicians. Right. And so obviously it would only follow that they would have a natural affinity for what we're doing because it's probably similar to what they're doing. But I did a podcast on Wednesday for a pair of women that drive around the country and do this podcast, and it is about wine and music. That's what they're. It's a 2-hour podcast. It's about wine and music, cool. And they're not musicians. These are just normal ladies that are really funny, and they like wine, and obviously they spend a lot of time in Napa and things, but they loved it. They were ebullient about it. They were completely just gushing about how much they loved the record.
I don't even know what that word means.
Ebullient. It's expanding. Anyway. So
I have to call glossary on Sean several times. He uses so many words. Dude, glossary.
Sorry. Probably not even the right one. Anyway, I probably meant something else. But anyway, so the point is just that they're not musicians. Yeah. They don't regularly listen to a lot of jazz or anything like that. They don't regularly listen to a lot of instrumental music. Period. Yeah.
Saying is Pop Toast has a mass appeal. It has an appeal broader than musos.
Totally. Yes, and that was really nice to see because they're not musicians and they totally loved it. Telling people to go and they were naming off their favorite songs and reasons why.
That's kind of why I call it mainstream. That's kind of why mainstream gets into my definition of sort of what it is.
Yeah.
Because it's not an off-putting or it's not intimidating.
Agreed.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, it's not condescending or anything.
You
don't have to know anything to like it. You don't have to be educated or there's no entrance requirement to really dig it. It's still music.
Right. And that must be rewarding for you guys. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Did they, what we just give anyone a clearer picture of what it sounds like? Probably not. But they should go to iTunes and check it out. Yes. They should go to iTunes and check it out. Yeah.
Right, and go to fraudprofits.com and check it out. That will give you the idea because it must be rewarding for you guys. You know, you've obviously put your heart and soul into this music, your blood, sweat, and tears. And yeah, you want your musician buddies and friends to like it as well, but just regular folk to be moved by it, to feel something by your music, right?
That's been probably one of the most gratifying things. I mean, it's been gratifying to also get texts from people that I really respect that they've said nice things, of course. Yeah. But it has also been nice to realize that we didn't make a record in a vacuum. I remember I played my band years ago when I was still in Salt Lake. A producer buddy of mine had come to town and he was asking about the band and like, so what are your audience like? And I was like, oh, it's mostly musicians. And he went, Kiss of Death. Kiss of Death. You know, it's like completely like, but he's right in a way. You know, you're really limiting your audience. But it's like this is stuff that my sister-in-laws and her 2 and 4-year-old are listening to it at dinner.
Right.
And it's pretty cool.
Yeah. So that's fantastic. You know, one of the challenges when I've talked with other musicians and making an album or studio recording is when it gets to that place that it's good enough for, because you guys have to like it first, right? And you guys have to be satisfied. Mm-hmm. How do you know when it's there, when it's finished? And, you know, what were the discussions like around that?
Excellent question. There's an old studio joke which says that like, hey, you know, how do you know when you're finished mixing a song? And the answer to the joke is when you stop.
Right.
Because that's true. There's, you know, basically what happened was we got rough mixes to the point after a very short amount of time where we were pretty happy with them. Hmm. Like in a very short amount of time.
I was totally happy. Yeah. Sean is far more critical in that regard than me. So Sean would send me something and I would go, dude, this sounds amazing. And then he'd be like, he would send me the next revision of that. And so like 7 revisions down the road, I'm like, dude, I mean, it still sounds amazing. The first one you sent sounded amazing.
Yeah.
So.
So Nate and I did another record 10 years ago together. So he had a hip hop persona called Duty Bug. Oh. And we actually did a hip hop record together.
Cool. What's the name of that?
In much the same. It's Duty Bug. It's a record called Playground Philosophy.
Yeah, Playground Philosophy.
Awesome. But it actually came off.
If you order one from CD Baby, they can probably find like the one remaining one and like blow the dust off of it.
But it's good. I have friends that really like it. But anyway, the point is just that it's
the cobwebs.
Yeah, like the door the doors behind creaks open. But this is, even though Nate's put out a couple records before this, and I obviously I've been helping people make their own things for years, but this is the first one for me that's got my name on it. So,
which I'm stoked, by the way.
Well, yeah. and I'm
totally stoked that that happened. Yeah. And I don't know. I mean, we've been talking a lot, but I don't know if I talked about the fact that this guy's amazing. No. And you know, there was a point of contention amongst our friendship that I sort of had a bone to pick, where I was kind of like, dude, it's just not okay that you're a genius and not everybody knows that, right, and more people should know that. Yeah. So there was a little bit of polite harassment that went on. Awesome. And so I'm really stoked that this is like the first like Sean Halley. Yeah. Band.
I love you to death.
Love you, dude.
And he chewed me out at NAMM 1 year.
I did. You remember, right? I was like, it's not okay.
This is not okay. Yeah. So, but that's why I was so protective of it, because it was my first thing.
Sure.
And now that it's out and now that it's done, I've given birth. And now I'm totally cool with it. I'm like way less precious about everything.
That's the word.
I left some solos.
Same.
I left some solos and some stuff that I just never would have left before.
Same. There's parts of it where I'm like, okay. I guess. Okay.
Way less precious. Yeah. So that's been good, because I think that will mean that it won't be another 50 years until the next thing comes out.
Well, there's that too. And Shawnee, you know, I mean, there's an extent to where, yeah, if you could get it right after 50 takes, but how much juice is left there anymore?
Yeah, totally. Yeah.
You know what I mean?
It's always it's a sliding scale between juice and accuracy anyway.
Right.
Yes. There's always that, you know, the joke about it, you know, the first take is like, you know, feels right. Everything's perfect, except for it's got a few mistakes. And the second take feels better, a few less mistakes, but it's not quite as awesome. And by the third or fourth take, you're like, you know, you're running out of things. So, you know, it's always that way in the studio. And I think that now that that stuff is done and it's out, and the onus is gone.
Yeah.
Like the great class on, it's like, cool, we can do this all the time. Right. Like I'll send you a video that'll come out here in a couple of days. And it's like, we did it in an hour and a half,
an afternoon or something.
So, yeah.
So. Fantastic. Yeah. Yeah. Cause these are your, you know, obviously not your real kids, but they're your babies. You got some attachment to these songs and, you know, you put your heart into them. So it's really great. We mentioned a few more minutes, and if there's something specific that if we've missed something, guys, you tell me, you let me know. We mentioned Dream Musicians, for when Fraud Prophets goes on the road and performs Poptosis.
Dream Musicians for that.
Yes.
I don't know. Although I did have a friend of ours, Brian or Agassi, suggested that we should do sort of like the audition files and actually shoot our auditioning of musicians.
Yeah.
You know, although that could be embarrassing. Because someone could walk in and go like, you know, I'm here for the audition, you know, for whatever. And we say, oh, for our band Fraud Prophets. And they go, wait, what?
Yeah.
No, I didn't know. What? And then leave.
Yeah, totally. It would be embarrassing, because it'd be like one, oh, you mean that stupid record that you sent me? No. No, I couldn't stand that.
I thought this was Spice World.
Yeah, this is Spice World 3, isn't it? Yeah.
No, I don't know. Do you have any like, do you mean like if we could choose like a star cast of characters to play with?
Anybody you want, and dream venues as well.
Oh, dream venues.
Wow. That's an interesting question.
No one's ever.
Why don't you take that one, Shawnee? Because I'm not sure.
So it's interesting. This is going to sound like it's weird, but you just triggered something in me in terms of dream venues. I think that.
The Budokan?
We'd have to play I Want You to Want Me, though.
Yeah.
We have to play some Cheap Trick.
Sure.
But I think one thing's interesting about. So I saw Snarky Puppy 3 or 4 weeks ago and hung out with the guitar player Mark Letary, who's a friend of mine. And what I was struck by was that it was the first time I'd seen an instrumental show in a long time with a badass light show. Mm. Meaning that they had. You know, for like Bob Reynolds, who played sax on the record, he plays the big solo on their new single, whatever their first single off the new record is.
Oh, no.
And they completely like turn on a light bar and did all these great things and put him in a spotlight. And so all of a sudden it was bang, it was intimate. And the thing about instrumental music sometimes is that it often gets played because there's not much money in it. So it often gets played on a very static stage with very static lighting at Catalina's Jazz Club or whatever. And
there's no production.
There's not much production in it. And I'm not saying that it needs it, but I was struck by how much it helped. I really dug the fact that all of a sudden, bang, the only people that are lit up are the keyboard player and Bob so you can really concentrate on the interplay between the two and that kind of stuff. It was really neat. So in terms of dream venues, it would be my dream would be to actually
Wow, I couldn't figure out where you were going. I was like, Shawnee, we're lost. I've never been in this neighborhood before.
Sorry.
How are we getting home?
Sorry.
I get it. No. That makes total sense. Makes total sense. I just didn't know. Yeah, I was where are we going?
So, yeah, I was just meaning that like, you know, dream venue would be cool.
Yes,
like,
dream venue.
Where it actually had, you know, where you could actually
A level of production.
Yeah. Where you could heighten the experience, because I think it really does help in instrumental stuff sometimes to be able to create a connection between the audience. Yes. Because sometimes it can feel very much like you're just projecting from stage, and that could be awesome too,
right?
But it's a different kind of thing. So dream venues would be someplace where it's still small enough to connect and where people can still see you and that kind of thing, but it's technologically where it sounds badass and it looks badass.
Whenever I think about venues, sorry to cut you off, but whenever I think about venues, like all of the historic jazz venues are amazing historic jazz venues. Yeah, so not to take anything away from any of them, the Blues Alleys of the world and the Blue Notes of the world and the Baked Potato here in LA.
Yes.
They're all amazing historic venues. And I'll speak for both of us when I say we'd all love to play any of those places.
Sure.
I will, however, say when I think of like, wow, where should we try to do our first gig? I'm thinking about like some of the rock clubs in LA. I think about a club like the Mint, you know, and while that might not seem very glamorous as a quote unquote dream venue, I just mean in terms of sort of, if I could add on to Sean's point, sort of a place where you can, I feel like what we do is almost more of a rock show than like a jazz show, you know, I mean, there are elements. And so, you know, and again, I know that's a sort of an underwhelming answer for a dream venue.
No, but I played the Mint before and like it has that mood. Vibe. The Mint has that kind of a vibe. I think it has the stage is sort of lit a little bit, and then the rest of the place is dark, and so you really focus in on that part of the room. And
you're not doing full production. We're not going to have 12 dancers or anything there. Yeah. I was going to talk to you about that. We do have 12 dancers?
Yeah,
That'd be great.
Yeah, they're basically, now the problem is they're all the original Solid Gold dancers, so they're about 80 now.
So there's someone wheels them around.
Exactly. So they've all got walkers.
Hey, man, it's a thing. It could be our thing.
It's totally cool.
It could be our thing.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, every band needs a gimmick.
Yeah, totally. Ours could be geriatric line dancers.
Oh my God, this is skewing very far afield.
Sorry, I finally woke up. I'm involved now. Sorry.
That's fine. The synapses are hitting now. So,
yes, exactly. They're firing, yeah.
So let me ask you guys, as we start to close out, you guys have got this great, I'm really looking forward. I've heard a little bit of the album. It sounds great to me. I'm going to go check it out as well. I'm looking forward to hearing about it. For folks who want to become musicians and get to the level where you guys are professionally, and even though there's been challenges, there's been successes, what advice would you give them?
I'll let you go first.
No, you go first.
No. Because what I have to say is very simple.
Oh, I would say keep an open mind. If you have a hard time being a fan of something, figure out how to be a fan of it. Figure out something that you can find that is edifying to you so that you dig it, because the more varying input you take in as a musician, the more complex and organic and interesting your playing is. If you only listen to one guitar player your whole life as a mentor, as a fan or whatever, you're going to sound like a pale reflection of that guy.
Right.
But if you listen to, you know, for me, like my CD player in my car, back when I had the 6-disc changer that you had to go into the trunk to get out, it had an Astor Piazzolla tango record in it, and Mr. Mister, and Sepultura, and a Coltrane record, and something else. Like it's about trying to become a fan of everything, so that when you take in all of that input and you create a gumbo, what comes out is flavorful and interesting, and it sounds like you.
Is it my turn?
Great. Yeah, sorry.
No. I wasn't being a smarty pants. I just didn't want to cut you off.
Yeah.
Dave.
Yes. Nate.
Did you have Legos when you were a kid?
I did. Yes.
You did, right?
Did you step on any?
So oh yeah.
I ate a couple.
So, yes, that happens as well. So here's the thing. So Sean is Legos. He's complex. They have like real like specific pieces. You can make these amazing things, and it's like incredible. That's Sean. I'm Duplo. I'm very simplified Legos. So Sean just gave the Lego answer, and I'm going to give the Duplo answer, which is almost the same exact answer, just in Duplo form.
Okay.
When I was coming up, someone once said to me, listen to as much music as you possibly can, play as much music as you possibly can with as many different people as you possibly can. That's it. That was it. Wow. And so that's as simple as that sounds, that is the Duplo version of, you know, what my advice would be to anyone coming up. I mean, that's where it starts. Obviously, you can get more specific from that point, sure. But that's the overarching premise.
And always try to find people better than you. Mm-hmm. And always try to find people better than you. I was really fortunate that when I was coming up, I was always the youngest by a certain like a large amount. So I was always the 15-year-old in the group of 19-year-olds playing or 20-year-olds playing, or it's the same thing with anything I ever did. But always try to find people better than you, because you will by far learn better and quicker and faster with that. You should definitely play with people your own age. You should definitely do that. But you should also find a way to get access to people that are more experienced than you are, because you will by far learn things. Even if you learn what not to do.
Right.
A lot of the time that's jam sessions.
Yeah, totally.
A lot
of
the time you're like the young kid
and
you go to like the jam session and you play, and then, you know, the old tenor player when they're on break goes, "Yo, young blood, you got potential."
Yeah, exactly.
Stick with it.
Now make sure you shut up right now.
Or, you know, it's like, no, I learned a lot from doing that.
I did too. Totally did. It was definitely the guy.
And that was my opportunity to play with older and more experienced musicians.
Yeah, totally.
And like you said, even if you fell on your face, you know.
You learned.
You learned something.
And if you've got one thing I will definitely say about that situation, jam sessions in specific, is that there is a concept of thinning the herd, where if you are an unpleasant person, if there's something about you that comes off as unpleasant to an older person, they will traditionally not give you any advice.
Right.
They will traditionally allow, the idea being that if you don't say anything to this person, the universe will probably take care of them, right? But usually what happens is take care of them. You know, the universe will
Pulp
remove
Fiction
them.
Reference for anyone out there who's a fan.
The universe will remove them. And the point is that if an older person does say something to you and give you some advice about something, that means they see some potential in you enough that they should give you some advice to try to help you, because it's very easy for an older person to be disgusted by someone and just say, I'm not going to say anything. I hope that I don't see that kid again. And that's different. You know, it's like my friend Corey Christiansen is a jazz guitar player friend of mine, and we go way back to college. And he was telling me that he had a story where basically he got called out by Jamie Ebersold one night. And Jamie Ebersold is a long-standing educator in our in the jazz world. And basically just for being tune shy, meaning that a tune got called live on stage that Corey didn't know, which is rare because Corey knows tons of tunes. And this was years ago. And he called him up and just said, "Hey, man, you know, you should have known that song," or something. And so Corey was really bummed about it, as you would be.
Sure.
But he was talking to a friend of his, and his friend goes, "Hey, you could look at it that way, or you could look at it by the fact that he has your number and called you." You know, so it's like every interaction you have that's negative when you're coming up, I think it's important to make sure that you have the right perspective on it. You know, growth is painful.
Right.
You know, growth is in its very nature painful. You know, if you check out that video online of the old rabbi talking about a lobster shell, where a lobster grows and grows and grows, and at some point it has to shed it actually has to rip itself out of the shell, and then it has to go away and hide. You know, under a rock for like months, so that he rebuilds a shell around it. Because, but it means that when you grow, you know, you break something and you become more vulnerable until you grow some new around it. But it also means you can't fit back inside the old shell. And it's important to understand that even negative interactions can have positive benefits if you look at them from the right perspective.
Well said. Fantastic. And so, you know, in closing, it's, you know, being good at your craft, because you guys are still growing and practicing and learning on your instruments, and really. Maybe.
Excellent.
I said you need to practice.
I think that's what I just heard. Yes.
He said. Hopefully, you guys are still practicing,
especially guitar
and maybe
player
you'll
guy.
Improve at some point.
Especially guitar player guy. Hope you practice more.
Hope you guys are practicing.
No, that's me. That's me. So. And you got to be a good hang, right? You got to be good at relationships. And you know, Nate and Sean, this has been a fantastic blast. This has been a great hang for me. Thank you guys so much. Go check it out, folks. Fraudprofits.com. The new album is called Poptosis. You can get it everywhere. iTunes, CD Baby, at your grandma's house, wherever music is sold, it's there, right?
Awesome. Yeah, absolutely. Yep. Thank you.
Fantastic. Nate
Thank
Morton,
you, David.
Sean Halley, thanks so much for being on Musicians on the Record today.
Thank you very much.
Appreciate it. Our pleasure.
Thank you.
All right. You guys hang there for a second, and we will be right back.
Awesome.